Screen share recording. We're doing just for the recording. We're covering several sessions on modern sculpture. We'll focus on Auguste Rodin today. I was lucky because I grew up out in New Jersey, just outside of Philadelphia, and right on the main Broadway there area that leads up to the Philadelphia Art Museum. There's the Rodin Museum, and they got a really nice collection of reproductions there. So from town.
Can everybody mute, please, Joe?
Yeah, sorry. And if everybody can mute their mics, thank you. So I got a nice exposure to Rodin starting out freshman in college. All right, so let's go to just start off with the Wikipedia, the Wiki art, and then I have documentary, other short videos. Most of you are probably familiar with, at least with the thinker of Rodin, The Kiss, Gates of Hell. There he is, there's the man. French sculpture, obviously. He's considered founder of modern sculpture. He had a unique ability to model a complex, turbulent, and deeply pocketed surface in clay. Also the Monument to Balzac, the Burghers of Calais, you probably may be familiar with that one, the Gates of Hell. Of course, he got a lot of criticism because it was breaking new ground, as artists who do that often are besieged with attacks and criticism. And his life over his career, he went through many development. You know, he started off classical, and then he was influenced by Michelangelo, and then he became more psychological as the psychology and Freud became hit the mainstream. So you'll see. He spent a lot of his early working years just doing decorator's work, just to live. You know, this is stay out of poverty, because his initial entries into the academy was rejected. So, and then he just taught himself sculpture on the side, and finally made it. He moved to Paris. So, let's see. He made a trip to Italy, which had a great effect on him, and because he saw the Michelangelo and Donatello statues in person. Other sculptors. I'll quickly peruse through some of these here and see gets down his comment. Rodin was a naturalist, less concerned with monumental expression than with character and emotion. Departing from centuries of tradition, he turned away from the idealism of the Greeks and the decorative beauty of the Baroque and the Neo-Baroque. The sculpture emphasized the individual and the concreteness of flesh and suggested emotion through detailed textured surfaces, rough surfaces, and the interplay of light and shadow. To a greater degree than his contemporaries, Rodin believed that an individual character was revealed by his physical features. So his talent for surface modeling allowed him to let every part of the body speak for the whole. The male's passion in the thinker suggested by the grip of his toes on the rock, the rigidness of his back, and the differentiation in his hands. What makes my thinker think is that he thinks not only with his brain, with his knotted brow, his distended nostrils and compressed lips, but with every muscle of his arms, back, and legs, and with his clenched fists and gripping toes. So the whole body is in this, is conveying a state of mind and emotion. Rodin saw suffering and conflict as hallmarks of modern art. Nothing really is more moving than the maddened beast dying from unfulfilled desire and asking in vain for grace to quell its passion. All right. Beyond the work of the Van Goghs, and he had an El Greco too. El Greco greatly distorted the human body. Instead of copying traditional academic postures, Rodin preferred his models to move naturally around his studio, despite their nakedness. The sculptor often made quick sketches. He was also a painter and an excellent draftsman drawing. He made quick sketches in clay that were later fine-tuned, cast in plaster, and cast in bronze or carved from marble. Rodin's focus was on the handling of clay, and he had a workshop and a team of people. George Bernard Shaw sat for a portrait and gave an idea of Rodin's technique. While he worked, he achieved a number of miracles. At the end of the first 15 minutes, after having given a simple idea of the human form to the block of clay, he produced by the action of his thumb, a bust so living that it would have taken it away with me to relieve the sculptor of any further work. Okay. After he completed the work in clay, he employed highly skilled assistants to re-sculpt his composition at larger sizes, because he also worked on commission for really large scale works, such as the Thinker. He cast the clay compositions into plaster or bronze, because clay deteriorated quickly. It dried up and cracks appeared, so you had to move it quickly into another form, usually plaster or bronze, and then marble. If he was doing marble, but he did bronze sculpture a lot. Rodin's major innovation was to capitalize on such multi-stages processes of 19th century sculpture and the reliance on plaster capping. Since clay deteriorates rapidly, if not kept wet or fired in terracotta, sculptors used plastic casts as a means of securing this composition they would make from the fugitive clay. So plaster cast was the most common way. He often used multiple plasters and treat them as raw material sculptures. So he did the different postures, different positions, and sometimes recombining their parts and figures in a new composition with new names. All right, so some of it looks unfinished, he was just doing part of the body of figures emerging from the block of marble. And that had a tremendous influence, powerful influence on later modern sculptors. Okay, so he became pretty well known after being working away in obscurity in his early years, and he was world famous. Traveled around the world, looks like. And then he willed to this French state his studio and the right to make casts from his plasters. Rodin sculptures are represented, so all these replicas are made from the original plaster cast. Rodin sculptures are represented in many public and private collections. The Musée Rodin in Paris was founded in 1916 and opened in 1919, okay, where he lived. And that holds the largest Rodin collection with more than 6,000 sculptures, wow, and 7,000 works on paper. So he was another, like Picasso, it was so prolific. During his lifetime, he was compared to Michelangelo. Most widely recognized as the greatest artist of the era. So he was up there with Picasso in terms of his fame. Unlike Picasso, when he died, his popularity waned with changing aesthetic values. I'm not sure exactly what they were. Sculpture became more abstract and less figurative. And for the most part, Rodin's working with figurative. So that's why. But then since the 1950s, near the North Myrtle Beach Airport. Since the 1950s, Rodin's reputation has been resuscitated. And he's recognized as the most important sculptor of the modern era. And the sense of incompletion offered by some of his sculptures, such as the Waking Man, influenced the increasingly abstract cultural forms of the 20th century. That's what I was saying. He restored the ancient role of sculpture. It had been back, it's just sort of a second cousin, not as important as painting, but he brought it up to prominence, to the equal painting. He freed sculpture from the repetition of traditional patterns, providing the foundation for greater experimentation in the 20th century. And that's who we'll look at later in other subsequent sessions. Okay. And then the influence he had on not just other sculptures, but on just on modern art has been tremendous. And there's Picasso, of course, Picasso did sculptures, but also in their painting, and there's a whole, it's incredible. So, Forgeries, let's see. Throughout of ease and making reproductions also encourage many forgeries. Rodin's one of the top 10 most faked artists. Right. Okay, so I just look through this the work here on Wikipedia. Let's get a sense, beginning sense. So that's him as a young man. Like I said, he was born in 40, so this is 60 days, 22 years old, right here. Pretty intense. Looks a little angry.
Scorpio.
Pardon?
He's a Scorpio.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, definitely yeah. Scorpio days there.
They're known for intensity, certainly.
I was a Scorpio, too. There's her then. John Singer Sargent, painter we covered there, did a portrait of him. That's done by a different photo, but there he is. There's the man, 1891. So he was.
That last one was done by a woman.
Why? What, the sculpture?
The one just before this.
I'm not sure. Male name too. Are you sure it's a female?
I think maybe. I heard there was a movie had a lover or something. Maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, he was pretty promiscuous. So let's not worry about that. Okay, let's just focus on his art right now. Okay. The Age of Bronze, famous sculpture, pretty traditional. But you can see maybe the Michelangelo influence. St. John the Baptist preaching. Okay, so he's sort of breaking with tradition with some unusual pose, unusual portrayal, musculature. This is a famous one, The Gates of Hell. It was a commission. I forget where it is. We'll find out. I have a short video on that. Very complex work. Amazing, amazing masterpiece. And it has the three. This is where the thinker is from. The thinker's own, the second level here. There it is. And you can see, Remy described that the thinking is not just in his head. It's conveyed through his whole body, the toes clasping the stone, the stiffness of the muscles, the oversized hands, very Michelangelo-esque, like the David sculpture by Michelangelo, whatever he's thinking about. It's, what's it all about? Who am I? Where am I going? Why is there so much suffering? Why does God allow so much suffering? Something fairly existential and significant, probably. Well, when you put it in the context of the gates of hell, then it makes more sense. The damned, hell, purgatory, heaven, So he's maybe thinking about the whole cosmological journey, like the whole meaning of life and et cetera. I think that's what he was conveying. This is a famous painting, group sculpture, The Burgher of Calais. This was during the Hundred Years' War between France and England. The Calais in northern France on the water, on the channel, had been sieged for a couple of years, and they finally stick there. They surrendered, and these are the officials of Calais. And in a great deal of distress and emaciated. But it's a powerful, everyone is an individual. And this are expressions of grief and sorrow and defeat and sadness and also strength. There's this whole combination, each one is different. So one of those great masterpieces. It's been in Korea. Again, he's got his team of work, people working from the past, their cast. What are his drawings? Okay, the walking man. Yeah, so he leaves off the head. And you begin to see more and more in that modern sculpture, just fragments of the body to suggest the whole, the part conveys the whole. You fill in the head, kind of adds a creative process to the viewer.
He could have done John the Baptist like that.
Could have. Yeah. The shade, interesting. A shade is souls on the way to hell. So it's one of the shades. The three shades are the shades are the part dead souls are being led into purgatory or hell. So this one of them. A little shame, must be a portrait. Mark from the mile.
What does that word mean? The one before? No, the woman before this one?
I'm not sure. Roche. I'm not sure what Roche means. My French is pretty poor. Look, then this famous painting, sculpture. I keep saying painting, I've been doing painting. This is for so long. The kiss. This is out there in the culture. You know, it's famous. See on Valentine's Day. Okay, that's good. Just our general overview. And then let's look at it. I'll go to WikiArt eventually. Let's see. There's him at work. We saw Monet painting. And, you know, video camera had been invented by that time. So when he was working, so they actually were able to capture great artists at work.
What year did he die again?
He died in 1917.
Okay, so it's very interesting. He's doing the gates of hell, and the avatar had to come.
I think I have a little sense of Rodin at work, who he is, what he looks like. Pretty intense guy. Here's a smart history, 3-minute analysis of the gates of hell.
Did you play a video of his life already?
No. No, I'll say that come at the end.
Thank you. We're at the Musée d'Orsay, and we're looking at a cast from 1917, the year that Rodin died of his The Gates of Hell, which is this huge project that the artist worked on for the last decades of his life that he never finished. And in fact, we're not even sure how it fits together because it was found in pieces in his studio.
We're looking at a plaster cast. It's impossible to think about doors without thinking about Ghiberti's doors on the baptistry of the Cathedral of Florence, which were called the Gates of Paradise because they were so beautiful. Because, of course, those depict biblical scenes from the Old and New Testament, but here we're really unmoored from that tradition, from that iconography.
Well, it's a literary tradition, and it's referring back to Dante, but ever so loosely.
So now, we have Dante at the top there.
Right, he's in the tympana. You know, that's also a standalone sculpture, which is called The Thinker, and it is here Dante gazing into hell. We should actually say this was a commission, and this was intended to be for a building on the site of the Musée d'Orsay, which was to be a museum of decorative arts, which was never built. But this was a commission that Rodin got, and when he had finished the design of the doors, he was ready to cast it, but then the project itself fell through, so he kept working on it, and the sculpture continued to evolve.
You do see so many figures that you recognize as standalone sculptures by Rodin. But the thing that strikes me most is just how much the figures emerge from the background of the doors. And I said background sort of in quotes.
And the doors should be in quotes.
And the doors should be in quotes,
because they could never function anymore.
But it's like the doors don't even look like solid forms. They're like vapor from which these forms emerge and spill out into our space.
It's almost as if we imagine the surface of those doors to be the surface of the ocean, waves coming forward and these figures rising and then falling.
Right.
And there's this constant sense of motion and undulation, form taking shape and then receding into indistinctness.
Eternal becoming.
The standalone figures that we're seeing are tragic. We have Paola and Francesca, Ugolino.
The figures who Dante finds in hell, being tortured and punished for their sins on earth.
All the way at the top, instead of angels, we have three shades. These are figures that repeat. One figure that's seen three times, almost cinematographic, but creating a unified form with shoulders that actually create a flat plateau and three arms that pull our eye down into the gates themselves.
You know, I'm so reminded of Michelangelo when I look at all of these figures and the expressive power of the body, especially the male body, and also the way that some of the forms are fragmented reminds me of looking at ancient Greek and Roman sculpture.
This is a really modern reinvention of sculpture, yes, clearly informed by Michelangelo, clearly informed by the classical, but this notion of the fragment itself, reuse, reworking, very much a modern notion.
The forms, although derived from the narrative of Dante's Inferno, come to take on a more universal significance about the human condition, about suffering, sin, emotion, and the power of the body.
All right. Yeah, complex work was just full of action and movement, and it kind of like gives a feel. If you've ever read Dante's Inferno, it's very swirling of action. Dante, being led by Beatrice, comes across these different souls and various pits of suffering befitting their karma. And it's also, you know, very few people read, it's a three-part book, just to jump on the Dante here, the Inferno, Purgatorio, and then Paradiso. Hardly anyone reads the other two. The only book that gets read mostly is The Inferno. People are more interested in pain and suffering and drama that way. As it gets more and more filled with light, there's kind of less action and you're meeting more saintly people. And for some reason that has not grabbed people's imagination if they want to read it as much. Let's jump up here. So challenging beauty. And this is what was also a central theme of 20th century art, modern art, challenging our Western sense of beauty and conventions of beauty in all the arts, and often getting very angry, hostile responses. Like I said, the
In the V&A Museum, we're fortunate to have 23...
evoking so much anger when that who wrote the latest painting? Stravinsky. Sorry, yes, Stravinsky was nearly killed. They had to whisk him out of there to save his life. People took their art pretty seriously. Their ballet pretty seriously.
Is this the V&A that you're getting ready to show us? The Victorian Albert?
This is what? Say that again.
The Victorian Albert Museum?
What about? Yeah, Victorian Albert. Yeah, that's right.
In the V&A Museum, we're fortunate to have 23 sculptures by Rodin, and all the large-scale ones we have are exhibited in this gallery. They show the development of his style from his earlier works of the 1870s, where he was very obviously influenced by Michelangelo and by classical sculpture, to then going through the 1880s, where he was very influenced by psychological studies and inner emotion. And these lead on to the 1890s, where he was really radical with fragmentary sculptures, really challenging traditional notions of beauty and appropriateness, and paving the way for modern sculpture. Rodin started work on this figure in 1875, and in spring 1876, he broke off from his work to go to Italy. And he was absolutely blown away by the sculpture of Michelangelo in particular, also Donatello, and also classical sculpture. So those were key influences when he came back to produce what he wanted to, which was a very beautiful male nude. At the time this sculpture was exhibited in plaster, people accused the sculptor of maybe casting it from life, so literally cheating, taking a cast of a human body. And Rodin was absolutely incensed, and in fact he never again cast a figure this life-size. The Age of Bronze, from the very outset, brought Rodin to international recognition, but it was very controversial. It was partly his choice of model, so Rodin decided to choose a soldier, and critics thought that it was utterly lacking in charm or beauty. The other reason why it was quite controversial was, what was it all about? He does look perhaps dejected. He's certainly internalized his emotion, and you can see that with his closed eyes. He would have been holding a lance in order to hold the pose, and Rodin took that away with the final figure. And so it's a bit puzzling. You wonder, why is the arm raised? What is it about? Why even call it the Age of Bronze? Is that about the awakening of humanity? Is that about even Rodin awakening to his own talent, somebody suggested? So it was very controversial. It was very, very far removed from the idealized beauty of sculpture in the previous century. After the controversy of the Age of Bronze and the accusations of it having been cast from life, Rodin reacted by creating this figure. And again, he had a controversial choice of model. He chose an Italian peasant called Pignatelli. And when Pignatelli came to his studio, Rodin described him walking up onto the platform and very naturally having his legs the way you can see them here. And Rodin was so pleased to have this spontaneous pose that he wanted it captured immediately. He decided that it was very appropriate for St. John the Baptist to depict somebody moving forward, energetic, speaking, preaching. And this element of bringing a fourth dimension to sculpture was one of Rodin's modern characteristics. He wanted to depict movement over time, and you see this again and again. Rodin was really interested in the play of light on bronze sculpture and the effects that you could get with faceting the bronze, so leaving it a little bit rough, but also leaving it with an interesting texture of different colours on the surface. Bronze, if it's left outside, naturally turns green if it's not protected because of the copper content in it. But Rodin decided that green was a fascinating colour for modern sculpture. And in this figure, you can see he's actually layered the patina. So you have green and black, and you can see both together. Mm-hmm. Rodin was endlessly inventive, so in his body of work, you can see the same form reoccurring in a different scale, in a different position, so he rotated and recycled sculptures. And this is an example. This figure appeared on the gates of hell. It appears here upright with its arms outstretched. It was combined horizontally with another figure to create a completely different work called Fugit Amor, so love fleeing away, being captured. And then he reused it 180 degrees, turned round, falling dramatically down. So this recycling, rescaling, reusing was very new in sculpture. This figure is called the Prodigal Son, but traditionally in history of art, in painting and sculpture, the prodigal son of the Bible story comes back to his father and is really contrite. But instead of which, in this figure, you don't have him with his head bowed, you have him with his head stretching backwards, and in fact, every ounce of his body is stretched out in distress. So he's using the body physically to convey the inner emotion of this figure.
Looks like a yoga pose.
This figure is the Crouching Woman, and it's one of the most shocking sculptures in existence. This cast is absolutely unique, and it quintessentially conveys Rodin's approach to the human body becoming more and more radical. It's derived from an earlier work called Iris, Messenger of the Gods, and you'd expect a classical goddess to be elegantly dressed, perhaps to be obviously beautiful, and here she's not. She's everything but. So her legs are stretched out in movement. But then he goes much further. Not only is the head absolutely not classically beautiful at all, but he's cut off parts of this figure in a really shocking way. In fact, so much so that you can see inside the work of art. You can see how it's made. And he was very keen on that being part of the finished work to show the process in which it was created. This is one of Rodin's fragmentary works of the 1890s, and this is where he was getting increasingly experimental to challenge your idea of what you would expect to see in a human form. Do you need to see a human form? Or could you in fact take the human form as the start of a piece that instead looks at light and shade and emotion? And in this figure, the emotion is completely internalized, so hence it being called the inner voice. You can see she's twisting in on herself on purpose, and the shape of her body is accentuated by the casting lines, the seam lines, which he's left on purpose here. He's actually making them a feature of the work. So you can see this human body as a series of shapes, as a series of textures with the rough against the smooth, and as this very twisted, internalized figure. This sculpture really is the essence of Rodin's fragmentary works. It's a head, it's a very, very large fragment, but in fact, in Rodin's mind, it's a finished sculpture. And he was interested at this stage in the play of light and shade on the bronze, and you see it really dramatically in this deep, dark cast. And the play of light on the back of the head particularly, which is no longer even curved as a human head is, it's bulging out. And so he faceted sculpture on purpose to produce these effects. Rodin was very influenced by classical sculpture. He'd have seen it in the Louvre, he saw it in Italy, he drew it extensively. And that was partly in terms of the human body, but even in terms of a plinth. When he had an exhibition of his own work in 1900, he used plaster casts of classical plinths to display sculpture. And it gives it a sort of status, if you like. But here it is a plaster cast of this classical plinth in his own collection, mounted on a wooden board. We've left it exactly as he had it. And there's a strut inside to support this incredibly modern bronze on the top. This is obviously a female torso, but it's quite abstracted, so there's nothing very clear about it. It's very ill-defined on purpose. From the back, Rodin described female models sitting with their legs outstretched in front of them. And he said when he viewed their backs, they looked like a classical vase containing the life of the future. So he's not just here representing a female body, he's actually conveying a concept. In July 1914, there was a major exhibition of modern French art in London. There was only one room of sculpture, and it was the Rodin room. So by this stage, he had absolutely gained international recognition. And he chose that group of works to present to the British public. In early August, the war was declared, and the casualties were immense. So by November, when these sculptors were still stranded in London, Rodin was very moved. He was quoted in the press as saying, "The English and the French are brothers. Your soldiers are fighting côte à côte, side by side with ours. As a little token of my admiration for your heroes, I decided to give the sculptures to the V&A."
That's like a brief overview of how he evolved. Let's go to Wiki, look at some more, scroll through some of his works.
Did you already do the Rodin Museum in Paris?
No.
Or one in Philadelphia?
Yeah, I mentioned it.
By the way, we have about 40 in North Carolina. They're made from molds.
All right.
Not the original, but they're in the North Carolina Museum of Art. It's really a fabulous collection.
Yeah.
In Raleigh.
I know, and Philadelphia, the Rodin Museum in Philadelphia is set similar. Because the plaster casts are owned by the French government, so they can make copies and just, you know, send them around the museums around the world.
So, Joe, do you know if the ones in Philadelphia are copies or are they originals? Do you know? I've been to the one in Philadelphia, but I can't remember.
Well, there are no originals. The plaster cast is the original. And then there's a certain number made of bronze sculptures from each one. So what number that is, yeah. But it's not like he just made one.
Yeah. Okay.
So wait a minute here. I'm not getting what I want. Wiki art. There we go. And this is the top of the Gates of Hell. And what I have here about the three shades, just generally. In Dante's comedy, the shades, the souls of the damned, stood at the entrance to hell, pointing to an unequivocal inscription, "Abandon hope, all ye who enter here." Rodin made several studies of shades, eventually assembling three identical figures that seemed to be circling the same spot. He placed them on top of the gates of hell, towering over the viewers below, then had them enlarge as a monumental group in their own right. As with the figure of Adam, those tortured whose tortured pose is mirrored in the three shades, Michelangelo's influence is evident here. The exaggerated slope of the head almost joins the figure's necks and shoulders in a single horizontal line. Through anatomical distortions of this kind, Rodin achieved an expressive force that was unrivaled in his day. Adam and Eve expelled from paradise. The sinner. So he's, you know, he's doing all these contorted forms. Like I said, almost like yoga postures, and getting attacked for doing it. No one ever.
What is this one called?
Called the sinner.
Oh.
1888.
Looks like a dancer.
Yeah.
The breasts are too big for a dancer.
Yeah, right. She's in some kind of anguish. She's suffering.
Yeah.
Eternal idol.
Yeah.
Interesting how I would keep. And Michelangelo was doing this at the end of his career. The whole series of Michelangelo unfinished sculptures, whether This is pretty finished actually, but where the figures just emerging from the marble block, half done, and it's still part of the block. And so Rodin did that in various ways. You know, he's got this channel here that the art lady is sitting in. The prodigal son.
I have to say that prodigal son, it sounds like he was proud. It looks like he was very happy to be home. He may have been contrite too, but yeah. Who knows what his life was like.
His posture and gesture in many ways. I mean, it's, in a way it's a gesture of joy, but it could be also great anguish and sorrow and begging God, begging his father for forgiveness by this outstretched way instead of head down. So it's ambiguous, which is good.
I'd say the joy has it. The scale.
The burgers of Calais here, here they are. Philadelphia has this too.
I thought the burgers were all together on one big door.
No, they're not on the door. They're freestanding. They can be put in different, more proximity to each other. These seem pretty spread out. I've seen them closer together for more impact.
I think there's another sculpture with all of them together.
Yeah, there is.
On a gigantic door at the Rodin Museum in Paris.
Right. And I've seen them mostly closer together. This one, this arrangement is unusual. What's this? Danaid. So that's a Greek goddess, yeah. They're merging into the stone. Okay, you know, it's almost the human body, and it's true, we all evolved from stone, right? Gas, stone. So that's wonderful that he would, that connectedness with stone, rock is still there.
So, well, what is that one called? That one's really gorgeous.
Yeah, Danaid, D-A-N-A-I-D. I think that's Greek from the Greek.
Oh, Danaid, okay.
Danaid, yeah, right. Monument to Victor Hugo. That's very great. That's, you know, it's such a slap in the face of conventional ways of portraying a distinguished artist or philosopher. He's like a little boy here. And maybe he's trying to convey that, you know, his brilliance was probably because he recaptured his childhood curiosity or something, you know. It's really interesting. The way his legs are just like a shy little boy. It's like a child. If you take off if you don't look at the head, just look at the body. It's like an overgrown child. So fascinating. I don't know if that was true of Victor Hugo. We had that quality about him, but we didn't want to.
I would say, wouldn't an artist still be in touch with how they felt as a child? Certainly.
Yeah, for sure. But maybe that was more, why is he emphasizing it here? That's what I'm saying. Yeah, to an extreme degree. That's what I'm saying.
But when did he paint this? I mean, when did he sculpt it?
It was 1890.
Okay, it's pretty old. Yeah, you kind of go back to childhood, I think.
This is a sculpture of Victor Hugo. It's not a self-portrait. Okay, he's portraying Victor Hugo in this position. It's not himself.
Maybe he's thinking of creativity being associated with childhood.
Yeah, right. Could be.
That's... And who are those other figures in the background?
I don't know. Not sure who they are.
Maybe they're muses or the, you know,
yeah,
various gods or goddesses associated with creativity.
Yeah. So, right. So something about the child state, the innocent state, which, you know, Victor Hugo is this distinguished philosopher, writer, so... no one would ever do this. So this way, people would be shocked when I saw this. You know, but it was daring, flying figure, 1891. Right now, he's doing things that have never been done before. Sculpture, Balzac mood with arms crossed. Right, so yeah. bust of Balzac. I studied Balzac. That's just the way they're usually arranged, the burgers of Calais.
What does that word mean, burgers?
They're like the elected officials, the town, town of Calais. The neighbors surrendered the city, and they would probably be imprisoned or maybe killed. So it kind of reminds me of what's happening right now in this with the steel plant in Maripol. These people getting out, you know, it's almost like that. The long siege. Their face is still connected to the stone.
No title.
Pens, P-E-N-S. I don't know if that refers to a Greek goddess, but it, maybe the word pensive comes from that. Thoughtful. Burgers again.
Berger.
Huh?
Berger de Calais. Berger.
Berger, is that how you say it?
Yes.
This is one of his most famous sculptures. You know, he did Balzac various ways. I think he admired Balzac, but this is brilliant. You know. I had him nude, and now he's covered in this, he's wearing this robe or cloak that's gives him more dignity, I suppose. But, yeah. The hand of God. Yes. Brilliant. This was 1898. This is the kind of thing you see on a cathedral.
Where were those masks?
There'd be three of these. I don't know where they were part of, or they were just created just separately for some commission.
Maybe a theater.
Yeah.
Did he do gargoyles?
Well, that's what I'm saying. They're like gargoyles from the Gothic cathedrals, aren't they? Eternal Spring. It's getting more, you know, the figures are dissolved, just barely half in the stone, half out. The definition of the faces is merging. Le Penseur. Looks like an Olympic discus thrower. The Kiss, famous, one of his most famous, everybody loves this one. It'll be interesting, we'll see what Brancusi did with this. Hopefully we'll have time at the end. I'll show you that right after we stop this. Just keep this in mind, The Kiss. We've been in Psyche. And news. Romeo and Juliet, 1905. Gustav Mahler, the famous German composer. Someone's eating and they're clashing their dish. And could you, whoever that is, could you please mute your mic?
I'm finished.
All right, please stop that because it's distracting.
I'm finished. I'm not muting.
All right, just unmute.
And I'm muting. I'm muting, Joe.
Adam, question mark. Let's go back to that. That's huge hands, huge fingers. Get out of there. The storm. There's only 90 of these, we're 73, so I want to scroll through them. Oh, it's a painting of his. Old man's face. Victor Hugo. Yeah, I remember the Philadelphia Rodin Museum. It got all these hands. Torso. It's the torso. Terminal spring kiss. I mean, that's all of them on there, right? Yeah, back to the start. Okay. The kiss. And, you know, he had a big impact on later contemporary modern sculptors. One of them, famous sculptor, Brancusi, who studied with Rodin for a while. Certainly in Brancusi's youth, he was influenced by him. But here is Brancusi's kiss explained and referred to the connection with Rodin.
We're in the Philadelphia Museum of Art in a room devoted to the work of Constantin Brancusi, an artist who redefined sculpture in the modern age.
Sculpture at the turn from the 19th to the 20th century, the great figure who stands out is Auguste Rodin, but still very much within that narrative tradition of the 19th century.
Rodin broke all kinds of rules in terms of the way he handled surface, fragmented the human figure, and took issue with the classical ideal of the human body. We can see that, for instance, in Walking Man. Brancusi comes as an outsider to modernism and to the art establishment in Paris. He was Romanian. He did go to the academy in Bucharest, but made his way as a young man to Paris.
So it's important to remember, too, that Paris really is the center of the art world for the 19th century. It's the home of what we think of as modern art. And in a way, at the end of the 19th century, we see artists wanting to leave Paris to find other traditions. There's this interest in something that was thought of as more primitive or more true.
And what's so interesting is that Brancusi brings that notion of a kind of primitive truth to Paris rather than having to leave Paris to find it. He comes from Romania, where there was a long-standing peasant tradition of stone carving and wood carving, a kind of folk art. And while Brancusi himself worked briefly in Auguste Rodin's studio, when Brancusi was more established, the younger artist, Isamu Noguchi, would work with this master. And one of the things that
Noguchi's work later in another session.
Took from Brancusi was the artist's regard for the nature of the object, finding its internal spirit, its structures.
We clearly see that here in this limestone sculpture called The Kiss. It's easy to fall into thinking, oh, this looks like something a child could do. This is so simple. It's so block-like. The forms are not carefully detailed in their depiction of the human body, especially if you think about the academic tradition that someone like Rodin is coming from.
Where there's a careful articulation of movement, musculature, of anatomy. But here what we have instead is an attempt to retain the materiality. This came from a block of stone. Look at the turn of the elbows. And yes, of course, arms do turn at right angles. But here those right angles are aligned with the corners of the block.
It's almost surprising to find those arms continuing around.
And lovely the way those hands clasp each other and hold the other figure tight. So much so that these figures, which are each defined only by the single incised line that separates the two, without which they could almost be read as a single figure.
Except that, of course, the figure on the right we read as a woman because that line makes it an arc, so we read those as breasts.
She is ever so slightly thinner than he is. Her eye is slightly smaller, but the eyes also join together to create a single, almost cyclopean eye in the middle of the forehead, and the mouths, which are lips reaching to each other, are here singular.
Brancusi is making something that reveals the structure of the limestone. We even have that sense in the simplified carving of the hair. And there's also something in that idea of the union of these two figures of male and female coming together, something primitive, something truthful, something about the human condition.
I think there's a real honoring of the material nature of this block. He's leaving it raw. It's not just the cubic quality, it's the surface, which is allowed to be rough. Look especially at the hair. We can use the term primitive, but I think it's also archaic. It's hearkening back to the tradition before the classical.
So outside of that academic tradition, you go to the academy, you learn how to sculpt, you learn how to make a human figure, you study human anatomy, you learn how to polish stone so that it has a high degree of sheen.
How radical this must have been after 300 or 400 years, from the Renaissance to the high polished sculptures of Bernini during the Baroque period to the academic art of the 19th century, where the technical facility was at a high point, to return to a basic, beautiful form.
This very much reminds me of Mayan, Mexican, other Toltec. Tradition going way back in Mexican history, and also South American, it's so similar.
Not the first version of the kiss. This is actually the fourth, and it was commissioned by an American collector who was interested in acquiring the first, but Brancusi said it wasn't available.
And it's important that it's not on a typical base that we think of for sculpture.
In fact, the artist didn't even want it on the piece of wood that we see it on in the museum. He wanted it directly on the ground. He said it would be a kind of amputation if it was placed on a platform. This is important to the idea of taking sculpture out of the academic realm, where sculpture had always been accorded a kind of high status, put on a high pedestal. The avant-garde has rejected the sophistication of the urban experience, looking instead for truth in nature.
Well, you could say that that is the very definition of the avant-garde, rejecting the authority and strictures of the academy and finding an alternative that speaks more genuinely to the time that the artist lives in.
Yeah, just I'll look forward to Brancusi. We'll look at him in more depth another time, another next session probably. But you can see he studied with Rodin initially, and probably his kiss is a saying, well, here's my version of it. And taking it further into breaking free of the more realistic way of conveying the human form. And so, you know, what was the aesthetic of Mayan art, modern Mayan and Toltec sculpture? You know, they had the ability to do the realistic figures and sculpture if they wanted, but they have these monumental, huge, very much like that, you know. So it's some kind of state of mind or state of, it's like conveying something more, maybe more primitive, almost like some, what I get in that is like, it's like the soul. It's like there's something that's more ancient than our outer personality or outer body that's within us. We evolved from stone. So if you're going to emphasize the stone part of it, the stone has a certain permanence and it's that the flesh doesn't. So, and the soul is eternal, like the most permanent physical object would be, say, stone. So it's something like that, I think. And the soul is simple, you know, it's just a simple it's not elaborate, doesn't have a lot of details, and just the soul, you know. And these two are soulmates. There's the kiss, Brancusi's kiss. It's like, that's how I, and that's what I get. I'm just talking for myself here. It's like a soul to soul connection. It's deep. It's deeper than Rodin's in a way. Because there's a merging here that's not evident in Rodin. Okay. So what time we got here? Three. Okay, so I've got this documentary, it's about 42, 43 minutes long. It's in two parts. So this goes over his life. Yeah,
before you do that, did you say that the relationship to the Toltec and the Olmec and Mayan sculptures was something that he talked about, or is that something other people have said?
They may have. I haven't seen it. I was just, that was just my own association.
Oh, I see.
I said that sculpture reminds me of the Toltec and Mayan sculptures that I've seen. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
But I bet other people have seen it, other art critics have seen it. So, and I'm not sure if Brancusi himself had studied Mexican culture, sculpture.
It's also similar to Scrimshaw. That's the Eskimo people.
Eskimo, that's right, yeah.
The Nunavut and people like that may have done.
Yeah.
Ahead of its time and created an
indigenous traditions that go way back, right? That's true. And almost like the totems, right? Of the Northwest.
Yeah, and it also reminds me of Polynesian.
There are more ways to faith, though.
Yes, that's right. There are all associations here.
More ways for me to bring up purchases with Pay in 4.
There are more ways for me to explore crypto with confidence.
There are more ways to PayPal. There are more ways for me to break up purchases with Pay in 4.
There are.
Il a rendu la vie à la sculpture, comme si la sculpture finalement était en train de s'étioler, de mourir d'une certaine manière.
Everybody can see the English at the bottom. It's in white, unfortunately. If you can't see it, let me know.
It's hard to see.
All right, but is it, despite the fact it's hard, is it? If you squint,
I can't see it.
Can't at all.
I can see it.
I can barely see it, but I can see it.
But somebody can at all.
Marsha Patton can.
Ça nous permet de faire la vérité, de faire la lumière, d'établir un peu, de comprendre un peu le fonctionnement à la fois de Rodin, sa façon de procéder, d'appréhender aussi le métier, sa personnalité.
It might be too straining to have to follow this in French with this barely legible white at the bottom. I'll skip this. It'd be difficult. It's a two-part thing. It's good, but today, let's see what else I got here. I'm going to have to improvise some.
Did you send it to me? Because I'd like to listen to it.
Okay, well, just go on YouTube, and the name of it is Auguste Rodin, Modeler and Sculptor. Part one.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Well, here's a little bit about Noguchi, and then I'll look for some. There's another one. Mm-hmm. years of Calais. All right, oh, there's one on YouTube, I'll find it. Burgers of Calais. Oh, that saved it. This guy cracks a joke in the beginning. It's good to have a little humor with art sometimes.
Let's go surprise her. Happy Mother's Day!
Oh my gosh!
My mom deserves the best and the best.
Hamv is a commemoration of a heroic episode in the Hundred Years' War. What has happened is we have six leading citizens who are offering their lives if the seed...
The beginning. Here we go.
Rodin also produces the Burgers of Calais. If you look closely, you can see Wendy's and Burger King and McDonald's. And of course, Burger King is back here with his head covered because the Whopper is kind of disappointing these days. Moving on. What we have is a commemoration of a heroic episode in the Hundred Years' War. What has happened is we have six leading citizens who are offering their lives if the siege on their city is lifted. This is actually Calais. And the British forces have besieged the city. The French want to get out. Of course, during a siege, you basically keep everyone in the city until they starve to death. That is not good for anyone. So instead, these six leading men, basically the people in charge of the city, say, look, if if we give our lives, if we come over to your side and you can do whatever you want with us, just free our city. And that's exactly what the British accept, because of course they have their own problems and they don't really want to take over Calais anyway. So we have this episode, and what we see are these six men walking to their death. They're going to die. They know they're going to die. And we're seeing their reaction during that walk from the city's gates to the English forces. Now, to heighten the psychological impact of the figures, they are spaced out as if they were wandering aimlessly or going through their own individual thought process as they move towards death. And we get very different reactions from each of them. They also stand at ground level to make them accessible to residents and provide more down-to-earth inspiration. So it's a very interesting piece, but the French government originally had put it up on a high pedestal away from the people. Why? I mean, why hide these faces, this expression? Well, think about it this way. We don't really want to think about our heroes having emotions. We want to think about them being heroic. We don't want to think about George Washington sitting at Valley Forge crying because he's well aware that his troops and him and everyone else he knows are likely to die when the British beat him. Because that's what he's thinking at various times. He must be, because of course the American forces are outmatched at various points during the war. But we don't want to think about that. We don't want to think about Lincoln losing sleep over the Civil War. We want to think of him as powerful, making all the right decisions. And so we have the same problem with the Burgers of Calais. This entire piece is about emotion, yet that's the one thing that we don't want to think about our heroes having. And as we look at these faces, we see different ways.
Well, it depends on the emotion. If there's the emotion of conquest and power, but we don't want to see emotions of despair or sadness or defeat, dejection.
Going to one's death. This man seems wrought with anxieties, with fear. This man seems just sad and depressed. This man on the left, very stoic, knowing what he's doing, knowing what he has to do. And the one on the right, you can see him trying to hold it together, looking stoic, but in reality, we can read that face and say, no, he's not really being stoic. He's putting on a brave face. And so Rodin has captured something very, very different. He has captured the emotion of the moment. Because of works like Walking Man, Rodin inspired an interest in incomplete works, and even this has elements and passages that would seem incomplete. We see that use of texture.
that seems a little incomplete, a little unfinished, but yet it captures the mood so perfectly. He uses the texture to give us a sense of the emotion that the people are feeling. Something very, very difficult, because emotions tend to be very small things. You do not walk into your dorm room after a rough day, throw down your backpack, and pout. You don't go, and your roommate goes, it looks like you're sad. You don't do that because you're not three. Instead, as an adult, you sit there and maybe you hunch your shoulders a little bit. Maybe you look down at the floor a little bit more, but it tends to be much more subtle. And so that's what Rodin is working with. He's trying to take these very subtle elements of emotion, these micro expressions that show upon our face, and he's trying to amplify it, and he's using texture to do it. So it's really an inspirational piece. Now, his ability to capture a moment and emotion, as well as recreating highly textured surfaces while revealing these deep themes, was also going to be inspirational in the 20th century.
Friends would walk up to me and just be like, what the f*** is in your mug? And I would just tell them, it's mud.
So that was it for me. Okay. I thought that was good. Bit of a close-up of the progress of clay, a little more background on what was happening, but also what Rodin was trying to do. And I like what he said about, you know, taking a micro momentary expression, those fleeting, actually, if you become sensitive to those, you might ask someone how you're doing, and they'll probably say, I'm fine, if it's in a usual social setting. But in the microsecond, fraction of a second, how they're really feeling would flash across their face. And then they give you, I'm fine. But the micro momentary expressions also tell you the truth of what a person's really feeling if you're kind of sensitive to seeing them. But what he did was take those and assuming, you know, maybe read up on them, who they were, and then amplifying the emotion and making them each one individual. Let's see if we got any more. Just did that in French. Story of the case. It's the same one. All right, this one, I haven't seen this, but I'm just looking for something there, though. Thank you.
Figures capture the most universal of human emotions, passion, contemplation, and despair. Auguste Rodin is known as the father of modern sculpture, an artist who managed to convey all the drama of life in stone and in bronze. This talent and these monumental pieces have now been on display for a century at the Rodin Museum here in Paris. This 18th century building was originally a private townhouse. The Hotel Biron changed hands a number of times in the 19th century until 1908, when Rodin rented the ground floor rooms as studio space, and the artist even lived here for a time. In 1919, this extraordinary collection went on show. Works in marble, bronze, and ceramic, as well as the sketches and photographs that accompanied his creative process. To tell us more about the collection and the artist responsible for it, I'm joined by Véronique Mathieu-Sy, who's in charge of the archive here at the museum. Hi, Véronique. Mm-hmm. Now, when we see a sculpture like this, so iconic, the kiss, it's recognisable in the whole world, really, it's hard to imagine a time when Rodin wasn't a respected, established figure in the scene. But in fact, when he tried to enter the art school here in Paris, he failed to get in.
Yes, that's right. Rodin did have a difficult start to his career. He failed the exam to get into fine art school 3 times. And that meant he would not be awarded the prestigious Prix de Rome scholarship. So he started out by taking less formal routes, a lot less formal, and that wasn't so easy for him. He began in decorative art workshops to make ends meet. Regarding the creation of the Kiss sculpture, it was commissioned as part of a monumental work called The Gates of Hell. The two lovers were meant to represent Paolo and Francesca out of Dante's Divine Comedy. Having said that, nothing tells you that it's them, and what you really sense from it is the celebration of love. The manufacturing technique is classic and perfectly executed. The sculpture is something every generation likes.
And I believe there was one sculpture that really changed everything for Rodin, and this one, The Age of Bronze. Can you tell us why this is so important?
Rodin at the time was totally unknown. He had high hopes for the sculpture. He was almost 40 and just back from a trip to Italy. That trip had been important for him, providing valuable training. He made the sculpture, in a way, as a tribute to Michelangelo. So he made The Age of Bronze, but the work totally rocked the boat with the critics and with the public as well. They didn't understand it. That's because it's a life-size male nude, and that broke with the statues of the time. Life-size statues normally were made to represent mythology or great men of the past, of history.
La mythologie, les grands hommes du passé ou l'histoire. Elle va faire naître une sorte
de. The sculpture sowed the seeds of debate.
Le traitement est tellement parfait.
The detail of the male anatomy is so perfect. The proportions, so much so that people wondered whether he had cast the statue using a living model. And that upset Rodin a great deal. The sculpture, however, gained public and critical attention. It clearly opened the doors of fame for him.
And the Rodin Museum celebrates its centenary this year. It opened in 1919, 2 years after Rodin's death. Now, can you tell us a bit about how the collection has evolved?
First of all, you should know that Rodin owes the existence of the museum to the German novelist Rainer Maria Rilke, who was his secretary in 1905. Rilke knew of Rodin's love for old stone and brought him here to the Hôtel Biron, this building. And Rodin fell in love with it. He quickly went into negotiations to make it his Rodin Museum. It was in a way the last battle of his life because he understood the importance and power of having one venue dedicated to his life's work. He was working then on his legacy. His goal was to teach young generations of artists through the presentation of his work.
One commission was to prove decisive for Rodin's career, a series of sculptures to illustrate Dante's Inferno. The sinners who feature in this version of the underworld include lovers, noblemen, and one man lost deep in his thoughts. The Thinker was chosen by the artist himself to adorn his tomb at his home just outside of Paris. Our reporters went to pay their respects.
Watching over the grave of his creator, Auguste Rodin's statue, The Thinker, sits above his tomb in the garden of this villa in a suburb of Paris, where he spent the last 24 years of his life.
Rodin is buried in this remarkable area of his garden, in the Issy Chateau, which he built here, and in front of this viewpoint, which looks over the Seine Valley. It's really the area that he liked the most in his home here at Meudon.
Rodin moved to this estate with his wife, Rose Beuret, in 1893. He was seeking peace and calm, away from the hubbub of Paris life.
Rodin had lots of friends and also lots of animals. He owned farm animals and some dogs. He also had horses to take his carriage to the station.
Rodin made the Villa de Briand his home and a space to display his sculptures. He used the workshop here to craft some of his most important works, including the Gates of Hell and this statue of Balzac.
Here in Meudon, he welcomed many guests, including the King of England and Eleanor Roosevelt. He would show them his workshop and his antiques collection.
Rodin was also a passionate collector of sculptures. He owned more than 6,000 pieces, ranging from contemporary works to artifacts from the Middle Ages, and Egyptian and Greco-Roman pieces, treasures that he would hunt out from Parisian antique dealers. Today, many are on display at the museum. This sculpture is being restored before it goes on loan to an exhibition in Denmark.
Here we have a fragment from a carved sculpture from Palmyra. There are many interesting pieces here that Rodin chose for his antiques collection. Some of them he used as inspiration for his own sculptures.
In 1916, 1 year before his death, Rodin left all of his property to the French state. His Meudon estate became a museum after the end of the First World War. It offers a unique and intimate insight into his life and work.
Some of these pieces are more than 100 years old, but their influence on contemporary art is still very present. And to tell us more about that, I'm joined by artist Marine Coutelin. Hi, Marine.
Bonjour.
Now, you've worked on Rodin in an academic way, written about him, you've researched him. But as an artist yourself, how important is his work to you?
One of the things that I find most interesting about Rodin is the way he organized his studio. That is, creating his own set of elements to play with. For Rodin, it was all about the extremities, hands, feet, limbs, and he had no qualms about taking one body part and attaching it to another group. It's as if he had a dictionary made up of shapes and forms, and he'd dip into that to make his work. One thing that really struck me was that Rodin lets us see the traces of the manufacturing process, and that's a deliberate choice. For example, on the portrait of Camille Claudel, he leaves the seams of the plaster visible. You can see the different parts of it. And up until then, I think sculptors had tried to hide that.
And your work takes a lot of inspiration from the natural world, from nature, and from movement especially. Can you tell us a bit more about the importance of movement?
When you first want to start making sculpture, what fascinates you is the movements that you've noticed. But then how do you re-inject that into these materials, into stone, into clay, or into plaster? Rodin allowed his models to move about. He didn't force them to adopt rigid postures. He let life play out before him.
Well, Marine's not the only artist to be influenced directly or indirectly by Rodin's casts and creations. The sculptures of Picasso, Brancusi, Zadkine or Ousmane Sow all bear the traces of his quietly revolutionary approach. We'll leave you with a glimpse of some of their work. Remember, for more arts and culture, do keep up with us on our website and on social media. We'll see you next time here on Encore on France 24.
I was thinking, you know, talking about movement. I don't know if I covered this before briefly, but this could go back to Michelangelo's David. Mm-hmm.
One simple but brilliant trick to cool your home in 90 seconds. Tired of hot and stuff?
Michelangelo was the first superstar artist. He was asked to sculpt a colossal statue.
Yeah. The view of it means for someone else.
Can you make it?
David is in motion.
Yeah. So, yeah, he's in a contrapposed emotion. He's leaning on one leg, but for the most part, he's stationary. And it's Goliath. It looks like he's already shot the stone from his slingshot. There's not a lot of movement. There's almost no movement. He's just looking, right? And then there's the famous one. And I'm sure that Rodin was influenced by Bernini. But Bernini is known to Renaissance sculpture, late Renaissance sculpture. Look at how he does it. Oh, in fact, somebody, here you go. 5 minutes. All right, let's do the smart history, because they look at...
We're in the Gallery of Borghese here in Rome, looking at one of several sculptures that Bernini, as a young man in his 20s, made for Cardinal Borghese here in this fabulously beautiful villa. And this is the sculpture of David.
I think I can see not only Michelangelo's influence on Rodin, but Bernini's. So there's his David. Look at the difference between Michelangelo's, his pretty stationary, thinking about what he's just done. And here he is. He's just in the act of using a slingshot. And look at the expression on his face.
So the story comes from the Old Testament and the young man who will become King David.
He's a shepherd, and the Israelites are in battle with the Philistines.
But a giant of a man, Goliath, is so powerful that nobody wants to meet him directly. But David takes off his armor and goes to meet him, not even armed with a sword.
He gathers some stones and he goes to face Goliath, and it is God on the side of the Israelites. David has that behind him when he goes to face and defeat Goliath, which he does with one stone from the slingshot.
Which hits Goliath between the eyes and fells him. David then takes the giant sword and severs his head. But this is the moment of action itself. When most people think of a sculpture of David, they think of Michelangelo's High Renaissance sculpture.
And that dates to the early 1500s. So here we are more than 100 years later, and we've moved from the High Renaissance into the period of the Baroque.
Bernini knew all about Michelangelo's triumphant sculpture, David, and it informs this. But Bernini is making this sculpture his own.
Well, we're in a very different moment in history. Michelangelo's sculpture during the High Renaissance was looking back to ancient Greek and Roman art, this interest in classical antiquity, this moment of humanism in the Renaissance, of idealizing the human body.
Creating a stable columnar figure, making the human body seem almost like a classical column in its purity, in its elegance.
Michelangelo's David has tension in the muscles and a lot of tension in the face and a sense of drama in the face as he stares down Goliath. But it's as though that drama that was just incipient in Michelangelo is really here unleashed by Bernini.
He's like a spring that's about to unwind.
Michelangelo gives us the moment before the fight with Goliath, and Bernini is giving us the moment where David is about to release this slingshot and kill this giant of a man, Goliath.
In fact, some people have said that they don't want to stand in front of the sculpture because it looks like that slingshot might hit them. Bernini is able to activate the space around the stone.
That's one of the big differences between the High Renaissance and the Baroque. With Michelangelo's David, we are very separate. We contemplate his ideal beauty, but here we're emotionally, bodily involved.
Look at the torsion in David's body, the way he's twisted and is about to spin that rock and unleash it.
The body crosses itself, which is not something we see in Michelangelo's David, and the body forms this diagonal line that has so much energy.
Look at the knit brow of his focused attention. Look at the way that the lips are pressed together, making so clear his intense concentration.
And you can feel that he's gathering every ounce of strength that he has to throw this stone. He's got God behind him, but he's still using all of his strength.
I always find myself wanting to say, you can feel it, when I describe Baroque art. And I think that's the whole idea of Baroque art.
It is a direct confrontation with the narrative. It is meant to bring us into the story. And Bernini does this so well that we forget that this is stone.
So that emotional involvement, that almost bodily involvement where we almost want to duck out of the way, is so typical of Baroque art. This moment in the 1600s when the Catholic Church is using art as a way to affirm and strengthen the faith of believers.
That was a major tenet of the Counter-Reformation, of the Council of Trent, that suggested that art was didactic, that art could be a teaching tool to help deepen one's faith.
Teaching is a funny word because it sounds so distant, but the art of the Baroque, it doesn't feel like a lecture. It feels like we're being brought in. It feels seductive.
Well, look at the naturalism here. Look at his understanding of the human body, of its musculature, of the skeletal structure, even in this enormously complex pose. This is an artist who has taken all of the lessons of the High Renaissance, but activated them and turned them to a purpose that even Michelangelo, I think, could not have predicted.
When I look at Michelangelo's David, I feel as though I'm looking at a figure that is superhuman, too beautiful to be someone that you would pass on the street. But Bernini's David looks like a man. He is depicted naturalistically, but he's not ideal. Like a god. That is such a High Renaissance characteristic. But the naturalism that you're talking about, we see in Caravaggio, we see here in Bernini, it's very much a characteristic of the Baroque.
These are artists that bring the Bible into our world.
Rodin went to Italy. He had to be influenced by Bernini too. And that's just Michelangelo. And I think you see that in his work. See if there's one more of his. That's one of my favorite. Let's see. Where is that one? Yeah, this one, Apollo and Daphne. It's a fan. It's unbelievable. It's it. I can imagine Rodin standing in front of this and using. He saw and later.
We're in the Galleria Borghese in Rome, and we're looking at one of Bernini's first major commissions, Apollo and Daphne.
This is a fabulous story of Eros, the god of love, causing quite a bit of mischief.
People may know Eros as Cupid.
And what happens is Apollo, the god of music and poetry, insults Eros, and Eros takes his revenge.
Eros fashions two arrows, one made of gold and one made of lead. He pierces Apollo with the golden arrow, which makes him fall in love with the nymph Daphne. And he pierces Daphne with an arrow of lead, which makes her repulsed by Apollo.
Now, Daphne, we should say, has dedicated her life to being a virgin, to remaining unmarried. This was very important to her.
And so she flees Apollo's advances.
But Eros gets involved again, and while Daphne is very swift and is able to flee from Apollo, Eros gives Apollo a bit of a push, and he catches up to Daphne.
Daphne has beseeched her father, a river god, to help her escape, and he intervenes so that at the moment that Apollo catches up with her, she turns into a laurel tree.
And that's what Bernini gives us. This is the very moment when Apollo catches up with Daphne, wraps his hand around her torso, and she begins to transform into that tree. And we can see the bark growing out of the earth, coming up around her, her fingers turning into branches and leaves, her toes forming into roots.
Even as Apollo reaches around her waist to touch her belly, his hand touches only bark. And so it is this moment of transformation. And what a perfect subject for Bernini, who transforms this rock marble into something that looks as if it's in motion and it's living flesh.
Typical for Baroque art, this caught moment in time, figures in motion. Apollo on one leg, the other leg behind him, the drapery flowing out behind him in midair, Daphne's hair also pushing back. We feel them moving through space. We feel the atmosphere around them.
We forget that this is marble, an unforgiving stone that is brittle and heavy.
Well, especially those laurel leaves that grow between them. They are so delicate and so easily broken. It's true. With a hammer and chisel, it is so easy to chip away and have something break.
This stands in such contrast to the Renaissance, where you have a sense of stability, you have a sense of clarity. Here, there's a wonderful sense of disorder, a sense of confusion, a sense of change and motion.
Well, we could think, for example, of an early work by Michelangelo, like the Pietà, where the forms take the shape of a pyramid, the most stable of forms. But here in Baroque art, we're interested in instability.
We see arcs. We see the arcs of the body, the arcs of the arm, the arcs of the drapery.
The drapery is my favorite because if you follow it and have to move around the sculpture to see where it goes, starting at Apollo's hip, wrapping around, going over his shoulder, and then finally moving around Daphne herself.
But it's important to note that the sculpture was intended to be against a wall, and it originally was. The sculpture is now in the center of the room, which allows us to move around it, but it does have its most perfect view in front.
And also to the side is a lovely view. And what's especially interesting to me is the difference in the expressions between Daphne and Apollo.
Apollo seems to have just the beginnings of a recognition of the tragedy that is taking place, that he's both catching up with and also losing forever his beloved Daphne.
Although it seems to me that he's on the side of, I'm still going to have Daphne, I'm still going to have what I want. His face still looks mostly tranquil to me, but his right arm reaches behind him, and the way that his wrist is flexed feels to me as though there's that moment of, oh no, something is happening.
A bit of surprise, especially the way those fingers splay out. And simultaneously, Daphne's face is both an expression of horror and of a kind of blankness. We see both her recognition and her loss of her humanity.
Yeah, I mean, this is a tragic thing. She has chosen to return to the earth, to a non-human form, rather than be beloved by the god Apollo.
But Apollo will continue to love her. And in fact, Ovid writes,
Apollo loved her still. He placed his hand where he had hoped and felt the heart still beating under the bark. And he embraced the branches as if they still were limbs and kissed the wood. And the wood shrank from his kisses. And the god exclaimed, since you can never be my bride, my tree at least you shall be. Let the laurel adorn henceforth my hair, my lyre, my quiver. Let Roman victors in the long procession wear laurel wreaths for triumph and ovation. Beside Augustus's portals, let the laurel guard and watch over the oak. And as my head is always youthful, let the laurels always be green and shining. He said no more. The laurel, stirring, seemed to consent, to be saying yes.
I had to stand in front of that when I was in Rome. There's hardly anybody in the museum. I don't want to leave it. I put my hand on the base just to soak in some Bernini energy. I kept waiting for the alarm to go off or a guard to come. Arrest me or something. That's what he did. It's an amazing sculpture. It's a, like I said, it has an energy field around it, and it's this motion and motion. And
that's so gorgeous.
Pardon?
Said that is so gorgeous.
Holy, yeah, it's unbelievable.
Swirling movements.
Yeah. Bernini to me was an equal of Michelangelo, or maybe even superior in some ways. But he doesn't have the fame or worldwide recognition that Michelangelo does. I mean, you know, art historians know about him. A lot of people know him, but not to the extent that Michelangelo is. And his Ecstasy of St. Teresa, you familiar with that? I've shown that before. Just one of the greatest sculptures ever.
What did you say about the relationship to Bernini and Michelangelo? I walked away and didn't hear what you said.
I think I said I thought Bernini was his equal, and maybe in some ways even superior
to Michelangelo. Oh,
yeah. That's EC.
How am I? EC.
ECS.
I'm a terrible speller. E-C-A-C-Y, right? Ecstasy of St.
Ecstasy,
yeah. So this is one of the great sculptures of the Western world. Let me do this in 3 minutes, all right? And it's from St. Teresa's autobiography, which was was a bestseller there around the time of Bernini in the 1600s. And she describes how an angel appeared to her and pierced her with a spear. And she went to a state of ecstasy. It was painful and ecstatically, spiritually joyful at the same time. So he did this sculpture. And
Auguste University has helped shape me in multiple different
ways. Some shrine, it was just part of it. See. That may not be a good one. It's in a church in Rome.
Her body, and in her words, left me utterly confused.
Okay, I guess we'll stick with this. May not be this one, right? It's only 3 minutes. Come on. Pause.
John Lorenzo Bernini was an architect and painter in the 17th century.
And sculptor.
He was one of the most remarkable sculptors of the Italian Baroque, an artistic and architectural style characterized by extravagance and emotional intensity. Bernini often combined his many talents in works of great drama and religious passion. In 1647, Bernini began the decoration of the Cornaro Chapel in the Church of Santa Maria della Vittoria in Rome. The chapel was named after its patron, Cardinal Federigo Cornaro, and honored the 16th century Spanish mystic, Saint Teresa of Avila. Among the works Bernini created for the chapel was the sculpture, The Ecstasy of Saint Teresa. Bernini chose as his subject one of Teresa's mystical experiences, in which an angel plunged a golden spear into her body and, in her words, left me utterly consumed by the great love of God. The pain was so severe that it made me utter several moans. The sweetness caused by this intense pain is so extreme that one cannot possibly wish it to cease. In Bernini's sculpture, the angel stands over the saint, clutching his golden spear as Teresa swoons in ecstasy on a cloud. Behind them, golden rays gleam in the light from concealed windows. The sculpture is a fervent expression of Bernini's own Catholic religious beliefs. The saint is represented as a great example of divine love and the benefits of Christian salvation. Bernini's chapel is a superbly designed space where dramatic effects are achieved by means of sculpture set between pillars, topped by a pediment. On either side of the chapel, statues of members of the Cornaro family sit in choir boxes, witnessing the central event. In the pavement are depicted two skeletons rising in wonder and prayer. Above, a fresco painted by Guido Ubaldo Abatini portrays the dove of the Holy Spirit accompanied by angels. But center stage stands Bernini's sculpture, a work of art whose passionately ecstatic subject is echoed in its form.
The way he did her robes, the flow of her robes like ocean waves, and it's like her emotion, her ecstasy is visible in the curves and waves of her robes. It's like just pouring out of her. You could feel it, almost feel it.
As the love of God rushes into Saint Teresa, it finds vivid physical expression in the dramatic ruffles of her clothing, the arms flung to her sides, and the tensed curl of her toes.
All right, so that's a pretty brief thing, but we could spend an hour analyzing that, but it's up there with the Pieta, with Michelangelo's Pieta, and Pieta is pretty stationary, stable. It's deep sorrow, it's a triangular format. The Mother of God, Mary holding, you know, the crucified Jesus. He's limp, and here it's just action. It's flow. Everything's flowing. Everything's moving. It's deep, deep spiritual ecstasy, and that's Bernini. Some of that got carried over with Rodin. I think he had to see all these modernized. All right, there's one more brief one. So we mentioned the Japanese Noguchi, Isamu Noguchi. We'll look at him in a little more detail, but here's just a little snippet about him. We'll end with that. She has a huge variety of forms and shapes and styles. Not just one little tiny sampling of his work, but you can see where modern sculpture went, breaking away from portraying the human form, just elevating the natural forms and taking what's there and reshaping it into works of beauty, works of art. And you can see that it's certainly the Japanese garden, Zen garden coming into his work, Noguchi style.
Where is that Nielsen Atkins Museum?
Good question. Why don't you do a quick search? I have no idea. I'd like to know.
You know, I have a hard time understanding that kind of art. Like the first piece looked like a bunch of bricks and, you know, kind of a broken down building with the bricks integrated with an old stone made of clay.
Yeah, so he's bringing in different types of materials and integrate. You see that in modern art, different types of materials and integrating them into one piece. It takes a shift, like it's like appreciating abstract painting. These are like the equivalent of abstract painting. So these are abstract.
That's why I don't get it. The one that I thought was
You don't like
not that much. But you know what I did like? I thought the one that looked like a happy face was interesting. Right. But what it really was were different round shapes and oval shapes.
Yeah.
On a flat surface.
Right. So, like an abstract painting, you approach it differently. You're not thinking, "What does this mean? What's it referred to in the outside world?" It evokes certain it's meant to, if you stay with it, it's like a piece of contemplation, what feelings, moods are evoked, what's the right, what just how the lines work within itself. Is a piece totally self-contained within, like if it's an abstract painting, within the frame of the painting, it's not referring to anything on the outside. It's a world within itself, and that as modern abstract sculpture is the same. So it's forms of nature that human consciousness has worked on to create a certain maybe surprise or feeling or a sense of contemplation or contrast or yeah. So it just takes a different way of approaching the work compared to realistic art, say, of any kind. All right, so that's a good place then. So we, I let go of those two 40-minute ones, but I just improvised it all here. It's just good. We saw some good ones, I think. Any comments? We got a few minutes. Any comments on Rodin or any of the other sculptors or sculptures we looked at?
Well, I love Bernini. I thought that was, thought he was really terrific. Yeah. And I've always loved Rodin. He's my favorite sculptor.
I love David. That was so good.
Bernini's David or Michelangelo's?
Michelangelo's
David. I like Michelangelo's, okay.
Oh yeah. My God.
Yeah.
Bernini's was good, but you can't beat Michelangelo because in Michelangelo's David, you could see the way he had just sculpted every part, every inch of his body was just so spectacularly immaculate.
It's a huge sculpture. It's more than life size. It's
yeah, what town?
I have a question.
In Florence, it sits, they have a copy, a reproduction out on the outside at one of the main square there, but the original is inside. But it sat outside for a long time, but the weather was going to destroy it. So they brought it inside and they created a a reproduction. Yeah. So
I have a question.
It's huge. Yeah, go ahead.
In Rodin's Woman Crouching, I think it was, where she had no legs, they would have been outstretched. And so you just see like this figure sitting with no legs. Right. But she said something that I didn't catch it about, something about a dancer and the look of the back of that sculpture. Right. Do you remember that?
Not her precise words, no.
It's just the torso.
Right.
And you just see the back.
Right. I know the sculpture.
And I remember the narrator saying her legs would have been straight out.
Right.
And then she said something and I didn't catch. It was a lot of information.
Sorry, I don't remember exactly.
Yeah. One of the things she said was the body was hollow and you could look inside.
Oh, that's right. This one with the hollow in the back. It's hollow out. The one of the arms and her back is open so you can look in. That's right, that one.
Joe? Mm-hmm.
Which sculptor is that?
Yeah.
Joe?
That's there.
This is an example of how Rodin repurposed poses.
Right.
This is a sculpture by Rodin, and it's kind of looks a little bit like the Thinker, but it's called the Boxer.
Oh, the Boxer, right? Yeah.
And it just shows if you look at it and say, oh, that's the Thinker, but he just repurposed the pose and made it.
It's like the Thinker got sat up. Right.
Can you show us the whole thing? It looks really nice. Can you lift it up a little bit?
Well, you better be a thinker if you're a boxer.
Say something. Don, say something and then your image will go full screen. Say something. Don.
Oh, what do you want me to say? Can you hear? Can you see it now?
Okay. Now hold it up. There you go.
Okay. Can you see it now?
Yeah.
My iPad.
Yeah, so it's like the Thinker shifted. Now he's sat up.
It's called the Boxer, but it's the same kind of pose as the Thinker.
Yeah, it's like the same body, same person.
Yeah.
He did that, right?
Yeah, this is
the hair's different.
Looks like Marlon Brando.
Yeah.
He does, actually.
I want one of David like that one in my house.
Didn't Simon and Garfunkel do a song called The Boxer?
Yeah.
I wonder if they were inspired by this. It certainly refers back to it.
I can't remember what the song sounds like.
Yeah, Boxer.
Did anyone else, commentators on the videos, sounded like their voices were hushed and they were describing Olympic figure skaters about to do a triple lux?
Well, they're inside the museum, so I think they had to keep the camera, so they had to kind of keep their voices.
You mean it was a bit too dramatic for you, honey bunny, right?
A little too melodramatic, I mean. Yeah.
Melodramatic, right.
It would be nice to look into Jurgis Sepkus, that Baba sculptor. He sculpted Baba's head and Mara's, and
I'm not going to do that. Like I said, this isn't Baba courses. I want to just stay with the... I think I said when I did the
other... Yeah, but it's now you. The second course, I mean, everything happens at once.
Pardon?
In eternity. Eternity. Everything happens at once.
Okay.
In eternity. So why not that too? Because this is a great manifestation. I like to see things that, you know. This is wonderful. I'm not faulting any of this, but I thought...
You're arguing with me. You know, you can look at it on your own. You can do your own class on Baba art if you want, but I'm not going to do that
here. I'm not doing class.
Okay.
I'm not doing class. No.
Right. Thanks for the suggestion.
I'm enjoying. I don't need direction. I know what direction I'm going in. Yeah.
No, I'm responding to your request. I'm saying
it's just a thought. It's a thought.
All right.
Yeah.
Hey, Joe, what are you doing next week? I mean, week after.
I want to continue with... more about Nagaguchi, Henry Moore, other modern contemporary sculptors, okay? And then maybe referring back to some, like I
did. Did you do Barbara Hepworth?
Yeah, her too, yeah.
Uh-huh. I'll
look for some others too, but contemporary sculptors is going to be the focus of international.
It's as usual, very good.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, all right, so see you in 2 weeks.
Thanks for all your work you put into this.
Joel, can we have an MVP?
Thank you.
Somebody said something. What?
I said, can we have it every week?
I can't do that. It'd be too much. Actually, we've been gone for a couple of years. And I think that's a nice pace to keep it every other week.
Yeah, I think it's a good pace to go.
Yeah. Just for me too, it takes some preparation. I don't want to be spending more time preparing for it. Now I'm also teaching in another course through adult eds with Coastal that requires some, and I do that weekly, so that requires preparation. So
I have another question, Joe.
Yes.
What did you think of Rodin introducing green into his sculptures? What did you think about that?
Beautiful. Green and black are beautiful when it's in that.
Of all colors, you know.
Yeah, well, what, like you said,
it's not intense.
Bronze turns green outside because it oxidizes.
Yeah.
So he just knew that, and he just did it as part of ahead of time. So it was a natural process that happens outdoors, and he just put it into the chemical process of the.
But it didn't look anything like it.
Like what?
When you put it in there like that, it didn't
look like the same as it would be weathered.
No, they're so different.
Did you like it or not?
Anyway, I thought it was an interesting choice of color for such an intense artist. Very intense.
Well, if you looked at the piece that I showed that was very green,
yeah,
you probably didn't notice it when I showed it on the
screen. It's kind of hard to see.
Very green.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's why it was interesting choice of colors. Yeah.
Alrighty, everybody. So did I stop the recording? Pause recording. All right. So that's it for this time. See you in 2 weeks.
Thank you, Joe.
Okay, take care.
Thank you very much.
Bye now.